City Club of Portland's Friday Forum. I'm Greg McPherson, City Club President. For 100 years, City Club of Portland is where civic-minded people come together to make Portland and Oregon a better place for everyone to live, work, and explore. We're gathered at the Sentinel Hotel, along with all of you listening or viewing on Portland Community Media or YouTube. The generous support of City Club's corporate and media partners enables us to put on the state's best civic programs week after week. Our media partner is Oregon Business Magazine, and our current Friday Forum sponsors are Bank of the Cascades, Stoll Reeves LLP, Family Care, Russell Fellows Properties, and The Standard. Additional program sponsors for today's program include the Oregon Historical Society and Portland Community College. Please join me in showing appreciation for all of them. We have two exciting events coming up on February 23. The first is an after-hours new member welcome at City Club offices. Meet other members and learn how you can become more involved. The next is caring for victims and survivors of sex trafficking. Join our Health and Public Safety Issue Forum at Kell's Irish Pub to hear directly from local service organizations working on the front line of this difficult issue. Next week's Friday Forum is entitled Atop the Glass Ceiling, Women in Leadership. Taking the stage are three women who have made it to the top against the odds, including Portland Fire Chief Erin Jansons. You can purchase tickets, learn more, and become a member at pdxcityclub.org. As always, we will be live tweeting today's program. Follow along and join the conversation using the name at PDX City Club and the hashtag PDXCC100. Later, our moderator will facilitate a Q&A session with our live audience. Asking questions at the mic is a benefit of City Club membership, but anyone in the room may write a question on one of the index cards found at the center of your table. In addition, members are invited to stay a few minutes beyond our accustomed end time to vote on City Club's centennial report following today's panel discussion. If you would like to vote today but are not yet a member, please see club staff at the back of the room to make arrangements and receive a ballot. The centennial report studied which City Club reports over the past 100 years were most influential. Speaking of City Club influence, we should note that this week, the Oregon legislature passed a bill to increase the state's minimum wage with a higher rate in the Portland area than elsewhere in the state, as recommended by a recent City Club research report. And now for today's program. 2016, City Club's centennial year, marks 100 years of trusted research, rich nonpartisan engagement, and progressive policy impact for Portland and Oregon. Today's forum continues our year-long celebration of the past and look to the future as we commence City Club's second century. As you know, Portland is not the same city it was 100 years ago or even 10 years ago. How can City Club continue to lead efforts to make Portland a better place for everyone? Young and active members, our guests, will share their visions for City Club and for our city in the context of our most influential research. Joining us is Aliemah Bradley, junior class president and black student council member at North Portland's Jefferson High School. Aliemah is also good for you, Aliemah. You've got a public out there. She's also a civic scholar with City Club. Next is Nichole Maher, president of Northwest Health Foundation and board governor of City Club. Nichole has received numerous leadership and industry honors, including Oregon's 50 Most Powerful People and Portland's 50 Most Influential People. Walter Robinson, policy analyst and constituent relations coordinator for Multnomah County, is also on the panel. Walter serves on City Club's Friday Forum Committee. Moderating today's discussion and bringing it into focus our notable research is Nova Newcomer, executive director of Friends of Baseball. With previous stints at Portland State University and Adidas Group, Nova is a member of the Oregon Council for Civil Rights and chair of City Club's Centennial Report Committee. Please welcome today's guests.
Hello, everyone. I want to start our event today by saying happy 100th birthday to City Club of Portland. Whenever I have a birthday, I try to reflect on the past year or maybe past years, but I always think about what is coming in the year and years ahead. And I think that's the most exciting part about a celebration like this, is where we are going. And I'm honored to share the stage with some individuals who will be able to share with you some ideas and perspectives about where we should go as a club and as a community. As you know, this year City Club is celebrating 100 years of serving the city of Portland. The club will be looking at its 100-year history filled with engaging public events and in-depth research reports on issues of great import. As part of its centennial celebration, the club's research board, in its tradition, charged a centennial research committee with the question, which City Club research studies over the past 100 years have had the greatest influence on our community and how? The committee's first task in answering the charge was to define influence. So I find it fitting to kick off our event today with a survey of our panelists' own definition of influence. So my question is to each of you, how do you define influence, and what responsibility is implicit for leaders and institutions that wield influence in a community? And we'll start with Nichole.
So when I think about influence, I think about an organization or an individual's ability to start a conversation, to bring people together, to essentially have movement on an issue or a topic, and to be able to create that change. And I think it's important when we talk about influence to not only think about the things that one can do with influence, but also the things that we don't do when we do have influence. And so it's very easy to think about accomplishments or potential possibilities, but what we often don't talk about in this community is those moments when we do have influence and we choose not to use it. And so I think throughout City Club's 100-year history, we have many instances where we have a lot to be proud of, some really profound accomplishments. In many instances, City Club has really shone a light on topics that we maybe have not talked about as a community. But I also think in that 100-year history, we have many instances where we have chosen not to use our influence. Topics about racial inequality, topics about income inequality in this community, we haven't always used our influence to talk about. And so, when you invite the question about influence, I think it's really important that we always reflect on what we've done well, and we always reflect on what we haven't done well and how we want to do it differently going forward.
Walter?
When I think about influence, I think about the difference between influence and power. And I think that the City Club definitely has a lot of influence because there are a lot of people that do want to be on this stage to speak to the city of Portland. But also I believe that the City Club does have the power to be the catalyst of change for the Portland we all want to see by bringing up the topics that Nichole just mentioned and also by even having us on stage right now. It's an honor and privilege to be here today, and happy birthday, City Club.
Aliemah?
Well, I agree with everything they just said, and I think influence is the ability to change the way people think. And I think when you're talking about having influence in a community, I think your job is to reflect on your influence and say, okay, I'm going to take this influence and how can I use that influence to help people who don't have that influence, right? I think that's key to having influence, is using your influence to affect change.
So Aliemah, I'll give you a follow-up question. I think everyone in this room would love to know what you're hearing when you're in your student council role, your peers at Jefferson, your peers in the city. What are you hearing that they want us to be talking about that we're not talking about today?
Well, I think first, the achievement gap is an everyday reality for me and my peers, and I think that it's something everyone cares about very much, is why do people who look like me not do well in school? And I think, I also think on a level of leadership, I think One of the questions people are asking is, why don't I have a seat at the table? Why does no one like me, or that looks like me, have any say in that discussion? And I think for us in student leadership, we're talking about creating our own platforms, because if people who have influence aren't going to give it to us, create our own.
So Nicole, I'll direct this one to you first, and if any other panelists would like to answer as well. Among the club's abilities, one of the most important is its ability to serve as a microphone for public opinion. In the 1945 Municipal Park Report by the Portland City Club, this ability was used to establish one of Portland's most treasured spaces, Forest Park. What topics or ideas do you anticipate or would like to see City Club take on that would, like the 1945 report, impact the city's physical landscape? And what community considerations are needed to develop such projects?
I'll be honest and say I'm not sure I totally understand that question, so I'm gonna talk about what I wanna talk about. So I think City Club is in a really interesting moment where we need to really think about who we are and how we are or are not reflecting who this city is today. I think about the fact that today 58% of all children in our public schools in this county are people of color. I think about the fact that 0 to 5-year-olds are significantly more diverse. And I think about the fact that those population demographics are just exponentially changing more and more every day. And I feel like we have yet to figure out as a club how to be meaningful in that conversation and really how to reflect our city. I think, you know, for some of the audience members who are here today, you may or may not know that OPB chose to not broadcast this conversation, which that's one topic about why this conversation maybe isn't important for that larger listening audience. But when I think about the city club that I want to be part of, I want to be part of a city club that pushes back on that. To me, when I think about the decision that a conversation for the next 100 years led by two absolutely amazing young African-American leaders is not something that the larger listening audience needs to hear, that's unacceptable to me. I think that this state needs to hear the voices of my colleagues. Interestingly enough, your friends and my friends are having very similar conversations. And so when I think about the City Club I want for the next 100 years, unless we can figure out how to expand our club membership and expand the topics of conversations that we are leading, we will not be able to have the deep and important impact that we did have on topics such as Forest Park.
I would like to follow up on that.
Yes, Walter.
I think that this city is actually in a very interesting transformation. And we have to look at that as a club. It's like, which side of the history are we going to fall on? Because we're at the point where we're going from a city town to a major metropolitan city. And by 2023, Multnomah County, the onus is going to flip. The majority is now going to be the minority. So how do we create a space that not only fosters and recruits people of color to top industries, even into joining the City Club, but how do we create a culture of acceptance that keeps people here? Because a lot of people come and leave. For instance, last year, the Friday Forum took a huge leap, in my book, by solely focusing on racial equity with all of our programs. Now, when we think about that, when we think about tickets sold to date, we sold 1,000 more tickets just by specifically focus on racial equity from last year to now. So right to date, we're 1,000 tickets short compared to what we did last year. And also, for the first time in years, the City Club's Friday Forum made a profit. Now, when I look around the room, it's nowhere near representative of what this city is. And I think the only reason why it is a sprinkle of people of color is because who's on the stage. And I think that that's very important to think about as we move forward, not only as a city club, but as citizens of Portland.
And I just want to add that I think that conversation about leadership and rooms of people who have influence reflecting the population or the people it's affecting is very important. And I think that that's one of the conversations me and my peers are having about leadership, is how to have that conversation. How do people in positions of leadership reflect and acknowledge their power and privilege in that spot, and recognize that, hey, the rest of us don't have that. Like, let's talk about it, right? Let's not just throw Band-Aids on the problem. Let's talk about this and figure out a productive way to make it happen.
I'm gonna do a follow-up with you then, Aliemah, on that. I'm particularly struck by the idea of the loss of creativity, talent, and new solutions when all voices aren't actively shaping how we approach public policy. And I have a colleague on my committee who brought that to our discussion and really helped shape how we looked at 100 years of City Club research. I think the idea that it's not an act of generosity to be more representative of the community, it's the path to addressing some of our most persistent issues and harnessing the talent of our broader community. So when we're researching these critical policy issues, how do we move City Club and our civic institutions from a more closed process that seeks feedback after the fact, to a process that is open, resilient, and curious, and involves more members of the community from the beginning?
I think that that's the problem, right? Is we don't know how do we do that, and so I think that's something that we need to take the time to figure out. But I think deeper than that, it's that we're not going anywhere, right? And it's going to continue to happen over and over again, and we're going to continue to, after the fact, when you ask us for our feedback, say the same thing. So how do we have that conversation? I don't know. And I think that's what I'm interested in learning about, and that's what I'm interested in figuring out, and I think all of us up here are as well.
Walter?
Okay. One, I think that the City Club has taken the steps to do that. They have a very rich history, a dark past, and that's all starting to change. But I think with some of the things that you are doing is, when I look at your board makeup, you have a great board, including your board members, Nicole, as well as Antonio Lara, and a few others, Carol Collymore, Zeke Smith, who are actively working to change their communities. And they come from diverse areas within the communities. You've expanded your issue forms, and now you've moved out to East Portland, which is a huge portion of the city that I think gets lost and forgotten. And I think it's also, we have to reflect back on what are we doing as a city club to pay onus to the entire city. Like, if you want to effectively engage communities, go to the communities. That's how you engage. You have leaders on your board that are of the community and from the community. Ask them, what's going on? How can we get involved? How can we actively be involved? It goes beyond just inviting people to the Friday Forum. It's saying, oh, what event are you having? How can the City Club be a part of that? How can we help shape the city, but also build up organizations while we're doing that? I would actually love to see us take this stage to East Portland for one of these Friday Forums. I think that would be amazing, and I think that would help further change the landscape of how we want to see the City Club.
So the Centennial Report, and indeed the discussion that we're already having up on this stage, discusses the importance of who is at the table, whether it's in making decisions and setting strategy or in scoping research charges or creating engaging public forums. And I think Walter just referred to location as being part of that discussion. So Nichole, I'll start with you. How do you think City Club can better grow its membership and its influence within the community? And what do you see as being effective strategies as individuals, as an organization, so that the club can be better?
So I'll talk about membership first and foremost. And so I think I really appreciate, Walter, you sharing that last year when we made an intentional effort to really reflect our entire community, we actually saw a significant financial benefit, and we actually saw an increase in our membership. And so I think we actually already know the answer. But we're in this interesting time where changing up our programming, inviting different people to the stage, the change that that represented can be uncomfortable. And I think that we're in this moment of opportunity and this moment of discomfort where there's a little bit of a rub. Frankly, there's those who have had a significant amount of influence and power in shaping who City Club is and have enjoyed the benefits of somewhat of a prestigious stature of City Club and somewhat of a level of what is oftentimes referred to me by other folks as a level of elitism. So there is this prestigious organization downtown, and that is something that folks have grown comfortable with and really matches their perception of what City Club should be. There's also, at the same time, a growing majority of people who may have a desire and who have shown through their willingness to buy memberships and participate that when we actually change ourselves to reflect who our city is, they're much more willing to participate. And so we're in this interesting moment where we have to decide if we want to continue to exist in the way that we have been. We know we will be much smaller and much less representative, and if we want to grow and really match the future, we're gonna need to change. And so I think that's where we're at today. The other reality is that when you look at our membership and you see where we struggle to get people to renew, on one hand, we have a very good membership retention rate, one of the highest in the country, I'm told, where 70% of our members re-up. Where we lose every time is when new people join, or when young people join, or when people of color join. For a variety of reasons, they don't choose to stay or continue to re-up at the same rates as others. I think that we have a responsibility to ask ourselves why that is happening. And regardless how you may feel about it, it comes down to simple math about our ability to be successful going forward is really going to be dependent on our ability to be an organization that welcomes, honors, and includes everyone.
Aliemah, as a young person, young adult, who is participating in City Club, what do you think, what would draw your peers to become members of the club either now or in the future?
Okay, well, I think part of it is that, as Jefferson High School, right, we have a City Club group of us that come to Friday forums every couple months. And I think when you walk into a room and there's no one else that looks like you, you're in high school and you sit at the table over to the side and you're just kind of like, wow, look at this. This is crazy. I think it's a turnoff. I think people don't want to come back. But I also think that it's interesting to me because like there's a network of all the black student unions in Portland, and we meet and we talk and we exchange information. And I think it's not hard to find us. And I think it would be interesting, you know, for to feel like people are searching us out, to feel like we want you here, to feel like we're being invited in, I think would be the first step, you know? Yeah.
I think we have a future keynote speaker for City Club Friday Forum. So let's change topics a bit. There was a City Club law enforcement report of 1948 that led to numerous investigations into vice and corruption, and I'll bring it back to where we just were. But it led to these numerous investigations and eventually the election of Portland's first female mayor. I think when you talk about changing the makeup of the club and where it's going, what starts to bubble to the top is the idea of reform. So what topics do you see the club taking on that would address systemic reform in the city or state that would be on the scale of that 1948 report? And I'd love to start with Walter.
I would like to see us look deeper into Measure 11. The MacArthur Foundation just did some work with us being Multnomah County. And they released a report that discussed the disparities. And as a member of Black Male Achievement Initiative, the steering committee there, that is our sole focus. It's because when you look at any disparity with any isms, guess who's at the center? People who look like me, and particularly Black males. So what I would like to see us focus on, if we ever did do a report on this, is to further look into Measure 11 and figure out how we can change that, because that's a constitutional change at this point. So how can we use our influence and prowess to look into that? Because I think that is one of the main key barriers that is sending young Black men and boys to prison along with all other people of color. So I would love to see us take a look into that as well.
Nichole?
I agree with Walter, and I would add that I think there are two areas that City Club could have a profound impact on, and one is an area that City Club has sort of dabbled around the edges in, but I think they could have a much more profound leadership role, and that is campaign finance reform. The fact that we are a state that has essentially no limitations on the amount that you can give and how that profoundly impacts inequality statewide and particularly in this city, I think could have a really important impact. And the second topic is really about a reflective democracy. The fact that we are a city who has a majority-majority, meaning more of our children are people of color than not, and our elected leadership at our city, our county, our state representatives do not look like the families and communities that live here, is an area that this club, I feel, should be outraged. And I feel that we have a unique opportunity to be a leader in reshaping who sits at every table in this community and makes decisions about the taxes we all pay. And I think this club has a really unique opportunity to stand together in a different way to really ensure that the values that we often espouse but sometimes struggle to demonstrate around having a shared destiny is something that City Club could play a really important role in.
Aliemah?
Well, obviously, as a high school student, the achievement gap and how kids that look like me are doing in school is very important, and I think it's something that everyone should care about. And I also think, the school-to-prison pipeline, all of those things, that why are the kids of people in underserved communities not doing well in this city? And that's something everyone should care about. Yeah, I think that's all.
Thank you. Okay. So I wanted to talk about the club's own past. And I think we're talking about this, and we keep returning to this question up here, but I think it needs to be looked at from different angles. So women were not included in City Club until 1973, and membership was not open to all members of the community until 1988. Obviously, this had lasting impacts on the organization, the entire community, and this exclusion reverberates in the club today, even as efforts are being made toward inclusion. So how do you think historical exclusion has impacted the club and the community, and what can be done to accelerate efforts to create a more inclusive and diverse club? So, and I'd say focus on what do we miss when our institutions aren't more representative? So rather than a statistic or a demographic, like what is actually missing when we aren't representative? Nicole.
I mean, I always share the example. So my heritage, my background is that I'm Native American and I'm also Irish. And I always think about what would happen if myself and 10 or 12 of my Native American peers got into a room and designed an initiative or a project or an effort in the African immigrant community. We would do a lot of research. We might even talk to a few key leaders in that community. And ultimately, no matter how well-intended we would be, we would not come up with the best ideas. We would not really understand what that community was going through. And we would, you know, probably not do the best job of utilizing resources to come up with the best solution for that community. And yet in Portland, and frankly time and time again in City Club's history, we've been totally comfortable having a room full of upper income people come up with a whole set of suggestions or ideas for how to approach a problem that's largely faced by low income mothers or low income families. And so we repeatedly make this mistake over and over again where we think that well-intended folks with some extra time and passion can solve issues for other people, and then we're repeatedly surprised when it doesn't work. Now, when I use the example of Native Americans coming up with a solution for African immigrants, people are like, oh yeah, that's a little bit strange. That sounds crazy. But we don't have that same lens when we have a room full of well-intentioned liberal white folks doing that for communities of color or for low-income people. Now, it is true that in order to have a better conversation, that means some of us are going to have to get up and give our seat away and share the table differently. But we're not saying, white Portland, we don't still need you. We don't still need you as an ally. You still have very important things to contribute. We just need you to do a better job sharing in the room and recognizing that there are other people in the community with deeper, better expertise that will help us get to a solution faster if we include them better.
Walter?
I love that question because you gave us a what and Nicole answered the how. I want to get at something that's kind of just larger than the city of Portland, but goes into the history of Portland. So what we're dealing with is culture change right now. Not just with the City Club, but with the city. And it's deeply embedded in structural racism. It's the system that we have created. And it's a special kind of system here compared to arrest around the nation. And for instance, if you want to know the dark past of Oregon's history through the lens of African Americans and people of color, please, please check out Why is Portland So White by Walida Emerja. It would shock some of you in the room, but also it may enlighten and inform you about our past, but also about how we can move forward in the future. I think that if we get at that and understand that, it's a system that is embedded in everything that we do, from what we watch on TV, to how we influence things, and to also how we vote and change policy, to even our hiring policies. Like, it's deeply rooted and embedded in our culture. And it's not just with white people, it's with people of color as well. It's been able to flourish, and it's going to be hard to break down a system that has had generations and generations of like horribleness that has made it come to where it's at now, that is making it much harder for us to combat. So I think if we look at that and how we fit into that and how we could actually use our privilege and understanding to change that, I think we can go towards the future we all want to see here in Portland.
Aliemah, do you want to add something?
I completely agree with everything they just said. I just say that doing things for people without them just doesn't work. Just stop.
So, well, I'm going to close and have this be the kind of the big dream question. So we're talking about 100 years. So what's one thing that you hope to see in Portland over the next 100 years? And Aliemah, I'll start with you.
True equity in education.
I really want to see our school board, our city council, our county, and those holding leadership positions across the city look like the children in our classrooms.
I echo all those sentiments as well. But I would like to just see us become a city that can be a global player. Like, we're growing, and we got to create space so that we can compete globally. And I think we can't do that without all that we've just said here. So,
can we give our panel a round of applause? You'll have to bear with me while I get my script out. I think this is the time where we get to ask questions from the audience. That there's a very specific thing I'm supposed to say about asking questions is a privilege of City Club, and I'm seeing that it's missing from my script. And Susie's going to help me out. Thank you for being patient with us. Okay, so yes, it's time to go to the audience for questions. If you've written a question on an index card, hold it high for staff to collect. I'll read at least one index card question. We invite City Club members to ask their questions at the microphone. And again, asking questions at the Friday Forum microphone is a benefit of City Club membership, and membership is open to everyone, which is newer in our 100 years. Please identify yourself as a City Club member and ask one question in 30 seconds or less. We do have a first question from Steve Schell, longtime City Club member and my colleague and lead writer for the Centennial Report. Please join me in appreciation for Steve's great work and service to City Club.
Steve Schell, member. Just a little plug. The research process is very important. It hasn't really been addressed on the stage very much in terms of reflection on that. We need to complete a project that was started by Ogden Charlotte Beeman, which is the research funding for the research progress in the City Club. We've raised $600,000. The goal is $1.5 million. We want to try to get there. So with that plug, let me ask a question. Mike has been listening to the comments on the board, and he suggested that I ask you a question that I care very much about is, What does a member-driven club activity look like in terms of where we are over the last 25 to 50 years and where we need to go?
Go ahead, Walter.
I think I answered that question earlier. Take this stage to East Portland, and I think that this would raise not only your membership, but so show East Portland that you actually care about all citizens of Portland. And trust me, if you take it to East Portland will come to downtown, because they have.
Well, I think that over the next 100 years, we really need to be thoughtful and open to really recognizing that is going to change. If you think about the dark ages before 2008, before there were iPhones and iPads, our world was completely different. The exponential rate at which things are changing in our experience in this world is changing related to technology, related to how people interact with each other. It is probably very likely that the way that we do things will change significantly, and we may not even have the capacity to understand how things will change going forward. And so I think that part of our experience at City Club is really this appreciation for tradition. And so I think that one of the things we will have to grapple with is, how do we appreciate tradition? How do we honor tradition? How do we recognize that we can be honest about how we previously excluded other groups and women, and we want to be different, and change that also honors what has been really important about this organization, which is the research aspect, the civic engagement aspect, and the creation of a space for folks to dialogue about what they think is important for their future. Those are the really important pieces of our tradition that we want to bring forward, but how it happens, who it happens with, and the platforms with which it is delivered may and should look very different. If it doesn't look different, it probably means we are not as relevant as we should be.
Aliemah, do you have anything to add there?
No. Okay. Is this working? Oh, yes, there it is. can't even say my own name. Win Wakala, City Club member. When I joined, it was at a time when you had to be sponsored, you know, to be a member. And then probably after 10 or 15 years, I went to work as a teacher, and I couldn't make it down here at lunchtime. So I think a large problem we have is that this is during lunch, and if we're saying, okay, who can get away for lunch, a lot of newer employees or people who aren't senior in their work can't come during lunchtime. And I do think one of the things we used to do is, when you became a City Club member, you were automatically put into one of the issue committees. And even if you didn't go to the meetings, you still heard about them and you got involved, and it was a good way to retain membership. Because if someone new joins and then they can never come to a Friday forum, they have no connection. So what kind of ideas do you guys have to keep people involved who cannot come to Friday lunch?
Nichole?
Well, I was attempting to address that previously, but I think that this idea that we maybe have to really open ourselves up into new and different ways of engaging is going to be really important. We have to understand that by choosing to have our discussions every Friday at noon, we are making a very clear and distinct choice about those who we are going to engage and which folks within what strata of our socioeconomic factor we are trying to include. We are making a choice. I'm not sure if it's a conscious choice. I'm not sure if we are being Portland polite and not willing to discuss it, but we make a series of choices about who and how we want to engage. And I think as we move forward, and our demographics have already changed, they will only continue to change, we are going to have more important and difficult conversations about who we want to be going forward. And having that conversation will likely lead us to change some of our strategies.
We have both of our panelists want to add. So, okay, go ahead, Aliemah.
I was just going to say, yeah, I can't miss pre-calculus every Friday, guys. I can't do it. I can't do it. I'm sorry. It's not going to work.
Also, we got to change the platforms in which we deliver our information. I tend to see more email and Facebook, but the new generation coming up, they could care less about Facebook. Like, they're all about Snapchat, Instagram. How can you keep the prestige of City Club, but also market it differently? That's pretty much it. And the website is pretty cool, but could use a few changes. In the tech forum, I don't know how many people were able to come to the Friday forum about tech inclusion. If you were there, you saw this huge screen on stage that when you swiped up, It turned green when you swipe down, it turned red, and that was based on if you liked what the people on the stage were saying. I think that using that and the information that we were able to collect could drastically transform the City Club as far as the data we collect and also the technology we're using.
Go to a question at the mic. Are there any index cards just before we take the next question at the mic?
Bill Dickey, City Club member. I'm kind of want to break the rules today and do a couple of different things. One, Walter, did you soft sell your student governmental experience?
I didn't. I was asked last minute to do this, so I really didn't have time to put a full bio together. But I will say that I don't just work for Multnomah County. I work for Multnomah County Commissioner Jules Bailey. And also, yes, if you want me to say it, Bill, I will. I was also student body president of Willamette University.
Yeah, so come on, Walter. Run for office. You've already been in,
Maybe, but I'm seeing the stresses of campaign life right now.
Okay, well, nevertheless, I also woke up this morning slightly inspired. I talked to some of the Historical Society, and I was under the impression that today's topic was more of a 100 birthday party than the topic that we've actually had today. So I brought a check with me today to make a donation, and I wanted to see if I could get anybody to join me in supporting the club, because regardless if you want to change the club, it's going to cost money to run this place. And so I brought a check for $10,000 with me today. I was doing that because Walter was on the stage. No,
hey, Bill. Bill, you don't have to donate to the City Club. You can donate it to the Walter Robinson Foundation. And can take care of a few things there. So thank you, sir. Thank you. We'll talk later.
Really, what I'm looking for is some people to join me in making, like a circle giver that wants to give $1,000, I'll match your $1,000. Or if there's $100 people in the room, if you want to give $100, I'll match your $100. But I want to get up to $10,000 today so we can continue to fund the club and have a great club that we do at this point in time. Thank you.
Virginia Cornyn, City Club member. Bill is always a hard act to follow, but especially today. My quick reading of the report is that City Club, like many other organizations, is better at lessons identified than lessons learned. So my question to all of you is, of the changes that have been made in the last couple of years, Civic Scholars being one of those, what are some of your suggestions to make sure that those end up being lessons learned, not lessons identified?
Someone like to kick that off?
I'll kick that off. You have an amazing young leader on stage, and you have an amazing network to young folks. Your Civic Scholars program is awesome. And that's also a privilege and an honor, because even how you end up on Civic Scholars is a very interesting process. So I think let's take that a step further, because we're talking about how do we better engage young people. But again, it's like you got to go out there and ask them and seek them out. So a suggestion I think that would be good with that is, universities, when they make up their board, they always make sure to include students. I think the City Club should do the same thing. And they have access to that resource with Civic Scholars.
Aliemah, you seem like you want to share something.
I just want to say that Civic Scholars is so amazing. And I want to give a shout out to Amanda. I don't know if she's in the room right now. But you are amazing, and I think that City Club should be tapping into Civic Scholars a lot better than they are right now. There's a lot of really amazing young leaders in my peers, and they would love you to give their feedback, and I think it would be very interesting to see Civic Scholars really be a more important role in City Club.
Next question.
Yeah, I'm Don Wagoner, City Club member, I think for about 50 years. Not sure, but anyway. However, when the proposal to add women to the membership came up, and multiple times, as a matter of fact, and I resigned, and for four or five years, I don't remember how long it took to do it. One of the things I remember, we had black members at the time, and one of the black members said, "Well, I don't see anything the matter with." I guess I don't even remember it. But at any rate, the idea was it's okay to be exclusive. And so I thought that was pretty bad. But at any rate, what I would like to ask is, why is OPB not carrying this message today? It's one of my favorite programs that I watch. I don't listen, but I watch the OPB offerings. And so what reason did they give for not covering this meeting?
Well, I think, to me, there might be two questions in there. One is the topic of exclusivity and the club's history to address. And then I think that we can, our panelists, to be fair to them, only recently learned about OPB not being involved, so I'm not sure that they have the whole history of why OPB didn't want to broadcast this particular forum. And I will join and say that it was a last-minute knowledge to me, too. So, Walter, I think that you wanted to respond to the question.
Exclusivity?
Or you
That's
seemed like
I was
you wanted
to respond to.
Yes.
I wasn't.
Yes.
Yeah. So the terms of exclusivity, if we do say exclusive, then I think we have to change our name. Because what makes us different than the Arlington Club or the Mac Club or any other club like that? Like, we are the City Club of Portland. And there are a lot of people that represent this city. So I guess that's my answer to your question as far as exclusivity is concerned.
Turn on. Yeah. Hi, everyone. I'm Mike Marshall. I'm the executive director of City Club. And very briefly, I want to explain that OPB felt that today was going to be an internal club conversation and that their radio audience wouldn't necessarily tune in to listen to it. I completely regret and I apologize to the panel profusely for not pushing back on that. I think today's conversation has been extraordinary and I think the listening audience would have found it incredible. I think it was about much larger issues than City Club, and so I take full responsibility and I apologize profusely to our panel and to the audience.
So I think we're out of time here for this part of the program, but we will be taking up a debate on the Centennial Report, with apologies to those members who were in line to ask a question. Please join me in thanking the panel, as well as Andrew Davidson of the Friday Forum Committee, who produced. We will now proceed with the formal presentation, debate, and vote on City Club's research report, A Century of Influence, 1,030 Studies in 100 Years. If you are a City Club member and did not receive a voting card when you arrived, please return to the registration table to be issued one. Voting cards will be used only for the final vote on today's report. This report, like all City Club study reports, is supported by the generous donations of members and sponsors. However, donations are accepted without regard to any donor's opinion on the content of our research, advocacy, or events, and City Club research does not represent the opinions of our partners, sponsors, and other donors. The report was written by volunteer members of City Club who were screened for conflicts of interest before they were appointed to the study committee. The committee was charged with the question, which City Club studies over the past 100 years have had the greatest influence on our community and how? Nova Newcomer, chair of the committee and familiar to you because she was just moderating our panel discussion, will introduce the committee and present the report. Upon the completion of her presentation, Nova will move for adoption of the report's recommendations. The meeting will then be opened for debate and vote by City Club members. Now I will turn the podium over to Nova Newcomer.
So I will start with our charge. Our charge was to determine which City Club research studies over the past 100 years have had the greatest influence on our committee and how. And as you'll see, we did a number, we counted the studies, and there were 1,030 studies in 100 years for us to consider. So early on, our committee opted only to consider comprehensive reports for this study, and to use ballot measure and information reports to provide commentary and context. We also did a little bit of numbers, by the numbers review of ballot measure reports outlining City Club's performance at the ballot box. So you'll find that in the report as well. What our committee did was we spent our first few weeks of meetings, and my fellow committee members will share in the pain of having to wait to dig into the reports to define what we meant by influence, but it was very important and critical to our ability to determine influence and then have reports bubble up out of that. So what we did is we said there are four important badges of influence. That a report triggered some civic action, usually but not always governmental. That leaders used a report. And there was a great quote from one of our witnesses, Governor Barbara Roberts, who said, "Put something in a report that I can use and I'll quote it." We tried to find those that evidence of that. A report caused or was a contributor in causing a shift in public opinion, which members might be interested to know that was a very, very challenging data point to try to track down. And that a report influenced City Club members in any significant way. We felt that because City Club is a civic institution, that the influence of City Club members themselves actually weighs in on these important social public policy topics. We also found that there was no absolute methods of weighing influence using any of these badges. So, you know, there's a tendency for opinion leaders to absorb the reports and then use the information as they see fit in their different roles. And they don't necessarily give credit, so there's not a breadcrumb trail for us to find where City Club has been influential. So we had to make inferences based on actions that were taken that seemed similar to the report's recommendations that we were studying. So some examples of reports that fit these categories. We talked earlier about the 1945 proposed municipal forest park was an example of civic action resulting from a City Club report. And then also the follow-up report, Forest Park, a Call to Action, a 2010 report chaired by Maggie Van Valkenburg, directly resulted in City Commissioner Nick Fish's leading a revamping of how Forest Park was governed and staffed. Examples of leaders using reports, the 1997 report, Domestic Violence, Everybody's Business, the implementation of, by the 1990 legislature of all four of the recommendations from that report originated from it. The 2011 report, Oregon PERS, Burdened by the Past, Poised for the Future, has been used by legislators and experts as a kind of standard for PERS reform. And please note that when we're talking of influence, it doesn't necessarily mean that we're saying that we as a committee or even the club themselves actually agrees with, you know, these are all obviously voted on reports, but that the club necessarily, all members agree on these reports, but that they were influential. Examples of shaping public opinion. We talked about the 1948 report, Law Enforcement in Portland and Multnomah County. The report was printed verbatim in the Oregonian newspaper. And then the 2006 report, Portland's Fire and Police Disability and Retirement Fund, Time for Change, helped the public and the city move to a different way of handling public employee retirement plans. And then an example of City Club member influence on City Club members, the fluoridation of the public water supply. City Club has returned to this topic numerous times. Members have continued to support fluoridation of water. And again, we know that that has not been successful at the ballot box. So, but the reports still were influential inside of the club and shaped the City Club's worldview on that issue. Even though the legislature and voters have not chosen to adopt the ideas in the following reports, initiative and referendum in Oregon and making the initiative work for Oregon. The facts, conclusions, and recommendations of these reports provide proof to City Club members that Oregon needs to change its initiative system. So there's a few topics where City Club members have continued to try to push push the state and the city on issues. What we also did in our report, so you'll find review of those influential reports. Now, what we're not saying is that they are, you know, by scientific standard, the most influential reports. What we tried to do was map them to the way we defined influence, due to how hard it was to find quantitative data to support choosing one report over another. But what we did do is, once we did that study, we actually included a section on the report called 100 Years of Research and Evaluation, and we looked at groupings of reports in two different areas. The City Club's worldview, so City Club has continued to invest research resources and the club's event time on topics such as parks and then government services, taxation, and finances. You'll find a very detailed review of the club's longstanding investment into those topics and also the results that have come from that longstanding investment, particularly around parks. I think that's an important section to read because I think it has lessons, and our committee feels it has lessons for other topics that the City Club could decide to invest in. And then finally, we also talked a lot about gaps, as you heard on this stage today. We identified several gaps in research topics and the historic lack of advocacy, particularly for certain critical community issues. And so we asked ourselves what research topics are missing and what kept research on important topics from being influential. So even when topics were discussed, did they go anywhere? So there's an important section in the report on that. So to our conclusions and recommendations. So our conclusions, we actually asked the question, is it worth it to do this research? And, you know, from doing the study, we said yes, with the following caveats. We felt that even though it wasn't how we defined influence, we felt that quality of reports is not only a City Club tradition, but one that should continue, and that these reports are written to last. That sustained interest in a topic by City Club increases the likelihood of influence for that particular topic. So the City Club can choose to look and dig deep into a topic and move policy on that topic. That the research process builds leadership skills, so that City Club's research process actually contributes to the leadership pipeline for the city, the region, and the state. The timing of a report and whether it is sparking public debate in the beginning of the process or whether it's bringing debate to a close is critical. Beyond influence, we discovered other issues related to the research process, some of which we've talked about here and some of which we have not. We conclude that the witness lists in many City Club reports do not adequately reflect all voices in the community, even though there's tremendous effort to do so. There's more work to be done there. The failure to revisit questions of racial equity in Portland since 1991 reflects poorly on the club and the research process. Particularly given the environment that we are in today, where these are critical topics for access and equity. That there's a need to dig deeper into the advocacy process following a report and have the club follow up in a more meaningful way. And this is, there's obviously an advocacy board and they do tremendous work on this topic, but need more resources to be able to do that. Also, that recommendations often have differing impacts. So recommendations that are inside of reports, they have differing impacts on various groups in the city. So even though there might be a prevailing opinion about a particular policy recommendation, that more needs to be done to look into impacts that might be different for different groups inside of the community, and making sure that there aren't that negative impacts to communities are minimized. And then also, I think a final conclusion is around the goals for City Club's research reports. And I think this is really important for members, that is the club's goal to provide information, or is the club interested in encouraging action on its recommendations? So there's some tension there about where to put resources and how the research process and the advocacy process work in tandem. So finally, recommendations. We recommend that the club continue its concerted effort to solicit members from all groups within the city. We talked a lot about that today. And our committee, it was a major topic inside of our committee. We recommend that at minimum the Advocacy Awareness Committee, possibly with the help of an intern, be charged to track an ongoing basis the influence of the club's comprehensive reports and utilize the research archive as a place to record evidence of this influence. Some of the work that we did would be great to capture and then move forward, going forward to track how a report is, how a report does after publication. Designating a champion. So if we're doing the advocacy process right, there's champions in the community that might be able to more effectively move something forward beyond City Club. And then wider distribution of research results. We recommend that the club research for broader distribution of its research by using a wider and broader distribution methods. And then finally, that the membership of City Club clarify its intention and predictable consequences for its research function. So again, it's answering that question of research versus advocacy. And may I introduce my committee members? Okay. So just very quickly before we move to the vote, I'd like to thank our advisors, Lauren Fox, Roger Eisen, Tamara Kennedy Hill, and our guest editor, Eliza Canty Jones. And finally, a huge thank you to our committee members, some of whom are here today, who spent countless hours in meetings, conducting research, interviewing witnesses, writing summaries of reports, and I think almost most importantly, engaging in challenging and provocative discussions about influence. So those members are James Philippi, Carol Ford, Tom Iverson, Sharon Maxwell, Alice McCarter, John Stride, and Kurt Webring. And a special thanks to our lead writer, Steve Schell. And I'd like to close with the future of research and influence for City Club will be highly correlated with who the club is in the future, just as it has been for its first 100 years. Imagine having the full brain power of our city turned on to analyze and make recommendations on issues that continue to confound us and make us less whole as a city. Imagine the ability to find and listen to one another. I move that City Club of Portland adopt the report A Century of Influence, 1,030 Studies in 100 Years, and its recommendations.
Thank you, Nova. We will now debate the motion to adopt the report. The microphone at my far right is labeled adopt, and the one to my far left is labeled reject. I will alternate between the two positions. Each member will have 60 seconds to speak. Our parliamentarian, Clifford Roque, will help me enforce our one-minute rule for member comments at the microphones by holding up a 15-second warning card indicating that time is running out and by ringing the bell when time is up. We previously tossed a coin, and I will first recognize a member in favor of adopting the report.
Thank you. My name is Chris Tobkin, and I'm a member. And I had the privilege of being on the City Club staff from 1974 to 1984. I know that was a long time ago. 7 of those years as executive secretary, which we changed to director, to be more less sexist, I suppose. Anyway, the club was falling apart back then, having the women's vote lost half the membership. They offered me $350 a month and told me there was enough money in the bank to pay me for 3 months. I think the club has come a long way since then. But to this report, I want to say that the ways in which club reports are influential really can't be measured. But the recommendations for advocacy, I think, are appropriate in this day and age, since the people who had the most influence in this community were City Club members way back when. Now it's a different ballgame, and it's a different city, and I think the club needs to find ways to integrate with the present. So I urge you to adopt the report. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. Do we have a speaker at the reject microphone?
Spencer. I'm Spencer Ehrman. I take exception with the first recommendation. It's been my experience after serving on several research projects for City Club that one of the strongest points that City Club has going for it is objectivity and lack of knowledge about the topics that it studies, lack of knowledge on the part of the committee, the research committee members. I think it would be a disservice to future research projects if members of research committees had intimate knowledge of the topics they were going to study before they engaged in that study. I would also I also refer to the final sentence in that recommendation, calling for diversity of membership, opinions, and persons interviewed are all crucial. The implication there is that research studies in the past have not sought opinions and persons from diverse opinions, and that is simply not true. Research is based on seeking knowledge. On the research projects in which I've been involved, we have sought opinions from all sides of an issue. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Spencer. Another comment from the adopt microphone.
It's your own.
Anne-Marie Claire, City Club member. I had the privilege of working on three long-range studies: increasing density in Portland, affordable housing, and the role of PDC. And I applaud this report that was just completed, A Century of Influence. Particularly, I advocate for accepting the recommendations, number six, which is also, the question embedded in that is, are reports just for information, or are we going to pursue them with advocacy? And in the greater discussion inside the report, there is this recommendation. If the City Club is interested in just being for information, the widespread membership and distribution of its findings are sufficient at this time. If we intend to have advocacy, it says, if the latter, increased effort to advance and track influence is required. This might range from more clarification of the role and greater support of the work of the Advocacy and Awareness Committee to hiring a staff position for advocacy similar to the position supporting research. I strongly recommend that in City Club examine hiring someone to organize the advocacy role.
Thank you for your comment. Another from the reject microphone.
Wynn Wakala, I agree with Spencer about our reports have always been looked at as very unbiased, and to have people on the committee, the research committee, that have a bias doesn't work. And I think maybe the committee didn't do enough research on the research, in that in the past, issue committees used to do informational studies. I don't know that we City Club does that anymore, and it's too bad. That meant anyone who had an interest, like my committee's health and public safety, we're all interested and have background in health and public safety. We could do informational studies. It wasn't a pro or con, but it was an informational study. And that's where you would get the people involved who actually have the background. And so I think they need to look at the broader picture like that and keep the research reports unbiased members and then include things like informational studies again.
Thank you. And another comment from the adopt microphone.
Just a quick comment about bias and knowledge. I don't think knowledge is necessarily a drawback. I think it's possible to be unbiased, even having knowledge, and even if biased, to contribute to an objective hearing of both sides on a topic. I think, you know, from my background in medicine, I would say that the real problem in having a study be objective or not is influence of money. And I don't think knowledge is the problem.
And a comment from the reject microphone.
Alex Linsker, City Club member. This is the only report where I wasn't able to find it online or in an email or on the event page. So in future, I'd love that to be able to happen again. Thank you.
Thank you. From the adopt microphone.
Kurt Wabing, member and also member of the committee. I just want to underscore the difference between research reports providing information or the basis for advocacy. I strongly believe that we need to do more advocacy, and the way to do that is to have a full-time staff member for advocacy, just like we have a full-time staff member for research.
Thank you. I see no one further at the reject microphone, so one more comment from the adopt microphone.
I'd like to address Spencer's comment and Wynn's comment as well. There was no intent in that first recommendation to specify that somebody with a bias would be appointed to the committee. That was not the objective of that. The City Club's rules are very clear on conflicts and avoiding those conflicts and making sure that we take citizens who are informed but not biased in any way. I don't see any change in that rule, and I don't see the distinction that's really made in terms of that particular recommendation. I move the previous question.
Well, and in fact, I think we don't need to have a vote on the previous question because there's nobody further at the microphone. So I'm going to close the debate. You should now proceed to vote, and you do that by taking the voting card that you were issued when you came in, or if you, like me, forgot to pick it up, go get one. Put your name on the ballot and indicate what your vote is, and turn it in before you leave. Those members who do not vote today will receive an email ballot, and voting will be open on it and through 5 p.m. Wednesday next week, and the results will be announced on Thursday. So that concludes our proceedings today. Thank you again to the committee. We are adjourned.